Are websites trying to block your requests while you're trying to web scrape them? How dare they? One solution is to use proxies. In this video, we'll cover what proxies are, how they help with web scraping, the different kinds of proxies, and how to use them in Python. Without a proxy, requests from your computer go directly to the server hosting the website you're scraping. The server then has access to your IP making that request, which isn't always a problem, but there's some techniques to stop web scraping that do use IP detection. Proxies are like pass-through computers for accessing the internet. Your computer makes a request to a proxy, then that proxy makes the real request to the website, returning its information to your computer. This way, the website only has access to the IP from the proxy, not your real IP. This way of disguising who's really making the request to a web server is critical in web scraping. Websites typically like to prevent web scraping, and one way that they do this is by implementing a rate limiter. A rate limiter basically says that for a specific IP, only a certain amount of requests in a time period are allowed. For example, 60 requests on a particular IP per minute. If a user makes more than 60 requests in a minute, the response will be blank, thus preventing any web scraping or any useful data even being sent back at all. This threshold is designed so that normal users of the website using it as intended will never hit this rate limit. However, bots that are careless in extracting data at scale will end up hitting this limit at some point. We can use proxies to circumnavigate rate limiters because rate limiters are tied to specific IPs, and when we make a request to a proxy, it gets the proxy's IP address, not our own. When you use one proxy, it doesn't increase your effective rate limit because you're still controlling one IP address. However, if you use a bunch of different proxies, then you get a multiplied effect by your normal rate limit for one IP times the amount of proxies that you control. In this example, to the website, it looks like there's five computers making requests. In reality, it's just one computer controlling five different proxies. This would multiply the effective rate limit by 5 because it has access to 5 different IPs to make requests from. There are many sites that offer proxies as a service. Although it's entirely possible to host your own proxy, it's typically more convenient to pay one of these companies. Two companies that I've used in the past are BrightData and Webshare.io. I'm not sponsored by either of these companies, but if you want to use my referral code in the description for Webshare.io, feel free. And subscribe while you're down there, please. This video took a long time. If you've ever used a service that sells proxies, you've likely seen that there's still different types. These typically are data center, residential, and mobile. Data center proxies are hosted on data centers like Amazon's AWS, Google Cloud, etc. These are the cheapest variant of any proxy and the most accessible and seen as the default proxy. However, these proxies are the easiest to detect as most real end users of websites are not connecting from a data center.
Residential proxies are tied to physical locations, typically from internet service providers like Xfinity, Spectrum, and AT&T. These are hard to detect as most real end users will be connecting from an ISP. However, these are fairly expensive as you're indirectly paying for an internet subscription from these ISPs. Mobile proxies use cell providers like Verizon, AT&T, Sprint, etc. These are the hardest to detect, and companies that offer these usually let you select specific cities to make requests from, which can be advantageous depending on your needs. But these are extremely expensive. BrightData in July 2022 is charging $40 per gigabyte for their mobile proxies. In addition to these, companies also typically offer these two types of proxy pools: static IPs and rotating IPs. With static IPs, you get a fixed number of IPs that do not change. These are usually pretty cheap and have a fixed price per IP per month. With rotating IPs, the IP of the proxy typically changes with every request. This gives you potentially access to thousands of IPs, preventing any realistic rate limiting. This type of proxy pool usually has no fixed monthly pricing. Instead, they charge more per gigabyte than static IP does. The main disadvantage is if you need to log in as a user, you'll be making requests from hundreds of different IPs, which is not a good idea as it's easily detectable that you're a bot.
The type of proxy you should use is highly dependent on the website that you're targeting. My best advice is to experiment to find the cheapest type of proxy that works the most reliably for you. Now that we know more about proxies, let's figure out how to use them in Python. And turns out it's actually really simple.
First, we have to go to the service that is providing our proxies. I'm using Webshare here, but other platforms have really similar interfaces. If you go to the proxy list, you can view all the addresses, ports, usernames, and passwords to all the different proxies. To make HTTP requests in Python, I'll be using the request library, so let's import that. Next, we can make a dictionary that looks like this. The strings on the right-hand side of the dictionary is a URL with the credentials to the proxy that we're going to use. Finally, when we're making a request, we can pass in the dictionary to the proxies parameter for any of the methods in the requests Python package to use the proxy defined in the dictionary we passed in. You can also define multiple proxies in the same way that we did here, and you can manage them yourself and rotate them in and out as you please. But Webshare has a free rotating proxy that you can use as well, so if you click on the rotating proxy tab on the website, you'll get credentials for that. If we put these credentials in the proxy dictionary, it automatically distributes our requests across all of our proxies, so we don't have to worry about that ourselves.
Now you can web scrape both confidently and anonymously, but to make sure you're making the most out of each request, be sure to check out this video on web scraping efficiently. Or if you want to learn anything you ever wanted to know about web scraping, check out this playlist.